Andrew? So just to see if you're still awake, I thought we'd start with a quiz. And Corbin already gave away part of the answer, but let's see if you paid attention. So who can tell me how many lines we have in our monthly detailed AWS bill? And I'll just help you along a little. Just shout one of the answers.
C.
C? I heard C. Any other guess?
B.
All right, there's some Bs. All right. 700 million. And while that's a big number, and part of my motivation here is to impress you with all the big numbers I have, there's actually something relevant behind this. So within the lines that we have to parse through every month, and I reassure you, we don't have someone actually look at them manually, there's a lot of complexity that we need to extract. So we have about 2,400 different applications that are running in this cloud ecosystem. All of those run on 80 different machine configurations, hardware configurations, which we call instance types. They run across 30 different zones. Those zones, think of them as data centers, essentially. And we have to manage them across 60 different accounts. So for those of you who are really quick at math, that's about 300 million combinations. And we have to make sure that all of those combinations are happy and well-provisioned. Of course, it's not quite that complex. We don't actually care about all 2,400 applications equally. Some of them are bigger, as Andrew mentioned. So even if you reduce this to, say, like 100 applications, you still have a million combinations. And even if you reduce this to assuming that all of your applications are equal and you can treat them the same, you still have about 100,000 different combinations that you need to make sure are provisioned, monitored, and everyone's happy. So why am I telling you all of this? Well, they're reason for those numbers is the reason why my side of capacity planning exists. And it's also the reason why we're currently the biggest side of capacity planning, which is the data manipulation, which we call capacity planning analytics. So how do we do it? Our goal is to try to help every aspect of the capacity planning operations. For that, we have three different, or complementary rather, goals that we use to implement to help that main goal. So the first one is to provide context and transparency. And those might sound vague, but I'm going to give you examples, so just be patient. So context and transparency is very important. The other one is once you have that context and all that data, you need to be able to actually do something about it. So we try to focus that context into actionable insights. And finally, if some of those actionable insights actually don't require a human to be enforced, we can implement some automation. Now that's where we tie back with our Coburn side of the capacity planning function. So by the way, if by the end of this talk I haven't covered everything that we do and you still have questions, Rohan and Torio are also in the team. They're sitting here and you can go and ask them questions. And if anything breaks, you can also blame them. So let's start with the first goal, which is providing context and transparency. And that seems easy because as I just told you, we have a ton of data. But I would argue that this picture here is a form of context and transparency. It's a horrible form of context and transparency, but it's one nonetheless. So obviously that's not what we give our capacity planners here. We actually try to build intuitive and interactive dashboards. So what does this look like? So this is one example that's tangential to capacity planning, but that's capacity related. So if you think about Netflix, when people are watching Netflix, there is thousands of different device types out there. Each device type might be running a different flavor of the Netflix user interface. And what that means is we see very different interaction patterns between those devices and our cloud services, and our cloud, those 2,400 applications. And because of that, we want to monitor devices that might badly behave or find good performance and see how we can reproduce that. So what we did here is we, for each one of our main user interfaces, we look at the range of what we call chattiness. So it's really the number of requests per device with some normalization. But you can think of it about device chattiness, how chatty a given device is with our cloud services. And the first thing you can see when you come here is that there is actually a pretty wide range for each UI. But aside for a few exceptions, the Plus Kids and the Akira here, everyone is fairly consistent. So that's already your first insight without doing anything. The other thing you see is there's actually quite a bit of variability over time, over the last 2 months or so. And if you want to drill down into that a little bit, you can go and select any of those UIs. It will update the bottom panel for a timeline just for that UI. And then maybe you can identify who is the culprit for that big drop or that big increase we got there in July, that big cycle. And then you have a ton of filters on the side to drill and investigate even more. And so I would argue that this is good context. It has a ton of transparency. And at least you can come in and get some intuition about what's going on. It has one major limitation, though. And let's see if you've been paying attention. We have to do this at scale. Who can tell me how many applications we have running in our environment?
C.
Yeah, good. You're paying attention. So we have 2,400 applications. Are we going to go to the application owners? There's probably not 2,400 of them, but the many application owners, and tell them to go look at the dashboard and try to see if there's an interesting interaction pattern that we should investigate? Or are we going to do it ourselves and go investigate 2,400 different applications manually by browsing this dashboard? I would argue that this is not the best use of our time. And this is where we get to our second point, which is focusing on actionable insights. It's great to have transparency. It's better if you can actually point in the right direction. So this is a different example, but I think it's a better one. So what we wanted to do is look at efficiency. So efficiency obviously impacts capacity, and we want to track it. We developed three different metrics. One we call efficiency score, right here, streams per dollar, and RPS per instance. And the bottom two are pretty self-explanatory. The efficiency score, you think about it of if you know which one of your resources is your limiting resource, memory or network, then how much you utilize this on average is your efficiency score. And so what's interesting here is we have a dashboard that shows the efficiency score, the streams per dollar, and the RPS per instance for all the applications. And people can go in the dashboard and explore it. But what we'll do is every week, we'll go into that data and we'll check for any changes, whether it's a change in the metric itself, so it just jumps in the last 7 days compared to the normal variability that we see for that metric and for that application, or even in the trend. So if your application was slowly improving the efficiency and suddenly you have a big jump, it improves a lot faster or it improves a lot slower, we'll also mark that as something worth looking into. And once we've run all this, this is not manual, we have code doing that. Once we've run all this, we send an email to each application owner with a list of their application that had something interesting going on in the last week. And so you can see here, this is an example where the efficiency score went up for two of the applications and went down for another one of the application. So if you've done something to your application during that week and you expect something to have changed, all you have to do is look at that email, make sure the change is about within what you expected, close it, and move on with your day. No dashboard. If, however, it's something unexpected, that's where it becomes even more valuable, because now something has changed without you wanting it to change. So what you're going to do is you're going to click on any one of those cards and our beautiful interactive and intuitive dashboards, and you're going to be able to investigate and drill down, and you get all the information you'll need down the pipeline. So this is how we provide actionable insights. So this is all great, but there's how does this apply to actual capacity planning operations? This is capacity related again, but we have actual internal operation, like making sure the holidays are provisioned properly. How do we do that? So in order to implement, to solve that capacity planning function specifically, we have three core requirements. There's more, but those are the core ones. One is to be able to monitor and classify our current footprint so that Andrew can go take a snapshot and know that this is how much we have reserved for that application in that zone for that instance type, and this is how much they've been using in the past 2 months, and make sure that everything is okay. The next thing is provide some level of forecasting for the future capacity needs based on current usage, based on expected events like migrations, holidays, Super Bowl, whatever else might happen. And that's also very critical to making it easier for Andrew to make the right decisions. And finally, the last one is helping him even a little further is trying to optimize what's the right balance between on-demand and reserved capacity so that we have still high reliability, but we limit a little the cost too. Where it becomes tight. For us, this is Picsou. So Picsou is two things. First, it's Scrooge McDuck in French. I'm French, if you haven't noticed from the accent. And we thought it was appropriate, given that it's a cost-related and sort of hoarding tool. And also, it's our answer to a comprehensive capacity analytics tool, so that most of the capacity planning functions can be served by that tool. What does this look like today? Wait, has any of you heard of ICE before? It's an OK. So at this point, for those of you who know ICE, we've essentially reproduced what ICE was offering. And that is a beautiful, interactive, and intuitive dashboard that tells you what's your current footprint usage, what's your current reservation, and you can drill down by who owns what and what products are they using and all sort of interesting dimensions. So that's where we're at right now. We just started building this a few months ago. Where we're going is, I would say, even more impactful. So where we're going with this is those last two points. So we've done the monitor and classify. So in the next 6 to 12 months, our team is going to be working on implementing capacity alerts and forecasts so that Andrew doesn't have to go every day and look at the dashboard and figure out what he needs to do next. We can go ahead and tell him, hey, there's a lot more usage and not a lot of reservation in that space. Maybe you should look at it. Similarly, we can help him figure out how much he's going to need to buy for the holidays by just telling him, this is what the growth looks like according to our best estimate. Once we have those forecasts and alerts, we can actually enhance them a little further by telling Andrew, well, you should pay attention to this, but also I think that if you do this action, so if you buy this much, then you should be fine. That should be enough. And then Andrew just has to validate this based on his own tribal knowledge, which he has a lot of, and sort of move on, process the purchase. But arguably, as we build confidence in that type of alerting and system, we can bypass Andrew sometimes. And that's where we would rely on Coburn's capacity engineering function to enforce those recommendations. So place direct purchase orders to AWS through some sort of API, or at least automate the spreadsheet we send them. So this is where we're going, and this is a lot of our focus at the moment. We've already done a ton of work on enhancing the data, but now we actually need to make it more actionable. This is super interesting and super impactful, and we're always looking for talented people to help us make it happen or even give us new ideas. So if you have any, please share. Thank you.